Welcome back, friends. So in the previous video, we discussed about preamble and we discussed about Article 1, Article 2 and Article 3. Hope you guys have the clear clarity about the Article 3. Okay. In this video, we will be discussing about reorganization of states, after independence, reorganization of states after independence, and then we'll be discussing about citizenship. Okay, you know, I have given mnemonics for you, mnemonics for all the acts which made this one, all the government acts, very simpler. So in citizenship also I'll be giving mnemonics. It will be very much simple, the citizenship. And then we'll be talking a few features of the fundamental right, then Article 12, if possible, Article 13 also, I'll be discussing in the same video, else in the next video. Okay, before going into the discussion, let's see. Many times many students ask me, sir, in offline also, when I teach classes, I give excessive emphasis on, remembering preamble. I asked the students for should to ratify preamble, to memorize preamble, on fundamental rights, fundamental duties, and DPSPs. Okay, these are always important. In fact, I ask each and every student to by heart all the 1 to 50 articles. So trust me, if you are sure with 1 to 50 articles, three questions will come for sure in Polity. That is, if you are thorough with 1 to 50 marks, you will be getting 6 marks. Okay, assume the cutoff is hovering around 100, around 100 marks. So if you are thorough with 1 to 50 articles, 6% of your preparation is finished. This is how you need to prepare. Please, because see, sir, you know what are the three layers of the earth? Crust, core, crust, mantle, and core are the three layers of the earth. Okay, crust, core, this is crust, top layer, this is mantle, and this is core. Okay, there are the most important, I always say to my students that there are top layer. Many basic questions come from the crust. Please focus on these areas. Please ensure that if there are any questions coming from the crust layer of any subject, the top layer of any subject, don't miss them. Most of the students focus on the in-depth questions of, sir, some questions are coming from ARC reports. Sir, some questions are coming from these reports. How we need to solve them? First leave this core part. First focus on crust and mantle part. Be thorough with this. Because all these, the questions on fundamental rights, the questions on preamble, the questions on DPSPs are nothing but crush the top layer, the easy questions. You should not leave even a single question. Don't rush me. I will show you the previous year questions. See how basic questions UPSC asks sometimes. See this question. Earlier we discussed preamble. The mind of the makers of the Constitution in India is reflected in which of the following? In which of the following, sir? While I was discussing this Bedubani Union case also, what it said in Bedubani Union case, preamble is not part of the Constitution. In that, Supreme Court clearly said, this one, it is a key to the mind makers of the Constitution. Or when we are discussing preamble also, what I said, it reflects the visions and philosophy of our founding fathers. See, very basic question, sir. That is preamble. Very basic question. If you are thorough, 2 marks. Very simple. Okay, see the next question. How simple it is. The economic justice, the objectives of the Constitution In preamble, what are the types of justice it provides? To secure justice. What are the types of justices our preamble talks about? It talks about social, economic, and political. The question is asking about economic justice. The question is asking about economic justice. So for sure, in answer, it should be preamble. So C and D, not there. So now it is talking about preamble and the fundamental rights. Next one is preamble and the DPSPs. Fundamental rights largely talks about political justice. It is the preamble and the DPSPs, which talks about economic justice. Again, the easiest question. And look at this question, sir. Which one of the following objective is not embodied in the preamble to the Constitution of India? Justice, liberty of thought, expression, belief, faith, and worship. Liberty of thought, expression, belief, faith, and worship. Thought is there. Expression is there. Belief is there. So what it is not there? Please, don't do silly mistake. It is asking which of the following is not embodied in the preamble of the Constitution. That is economic liberty. See, how basic, what kind of basic question? That's the reason I always ask students to memorize preamble. Don't, sir, please don't take fundamental rights, preamble, fundamental duties, DPSPs, and the parliament chapter for granted. Okay, these are nothing but the one of the easiest and the core area. If you are thorough, as I earlier in the earlier videos also I said the introduction video, 60% of our polity is finished if you are thorough with this just these chapters. That is preamble, fundamental rights, fundamental duties, DPSPs, and parliament. Okay, so please, if you have not memorized this one, please memorize always. Be thorough with. Please, sir, don't take my words for granted. Please ratify Article 1250. Okay, if you are very thorough with them, Article 1250 and preamble, you can for sure solve around 4 to 5 questions. Matlab 10 marks. Aramse you can do it. Okay, please. Once again, I request, kindly request you to do this. Okay, next, coming to the topic, reorganization of states. Yes, sir. So what is this reorganization of states? Reorganization of states is nothing but the demand for creation of new states. And one more demand is creation of linguistic states. Okay. Sir, our freedom fighters, okay, Jawaharlal Nehru, Mahatma Gandhi, and all these people were clearly in the favor of linguistic states. However, after 1947, if you see the view and stand of our freedom fighters, is they opposed the linguistic states. Why? For them, unity of the nation is more important. Okay, sir, how you can say this Jawaharlal Nehru and our earlier freedom fighters are in the favor of linguistic states? Sir, once when you are referring history, refer to 1920. Okay, 1920 Congress session, INC session, where it took place, sir, in Nagpur. In that Nagpur session, they said, we are in the favor of linguistic states, and they set up PCC, that is Pradesh Congress Committee. Pradesh Congress Committee, based on the form of linguistic province, based on the form of linguistic regions. Okay, these PCCs still exist. Okay, that is KPCC, Karnataka Pradesh Congress Committee, Kerala Pradesh Congress Committee, TSP, the TPCC, Telangana Pradesh Congress Committee. These are still existing. Okay, so earlier the freedom fighters supported the linguistic reorganization of states, but after 1947 they opposed it, considering they considered they pose as a threat to unity and integrity of the nation. See, I will give you one of the logical idea also. Nehru was very strongly in favor. Okay, sorry, yeah, Nehru was very strongly in favor of linguistic states earlier, but after 1947 he vehemently opposed. What is the reason Nehru gives is, suggest try to recall some names of European countries, Germany, Italy, Spain, Netherlands, France, and you take any Portugal. What are these, sir? Germany language, Italian language, Spanish, Dutch, French, Portuguese language. So what? These are nothing but linguistic nations. So Nehru has a very great fear. So today there was a demand for linguistic states. So there will be a later this will lead to a linguistic nations. Okay, that's the reason most of our this one after freedom after 1947 our freedom fighters opposed them. Okay, so still there are much demands for the linguistic creation. Linguistic demands by many states. Okay, largely the southern states. So then government of India in 1948. Sir, please. I'm expecting for sure. See, generally, I say all this reorganization of states and chronology is not that much important everywhere for prelims. I will say students to just have a cursory look. Don't give more importance to this all these things formation. But I am asking my students to focus particularly this year because I'm expecting minimum one question on this, considering the reorganization of J&K and the merging of Daman and DU and all these things. That's the reason, instead of directly asking any question, UPSC ask some historical background. That's the reason I'm expecting one question from this reorganization of states. That's the reason I'm discussing in detail. Sir, as many of you know, my approach towards exam is completely exam-centric. Okay, many of students know how earlier when I took current affairs classes, around 12 classes I took. How many questions? 24 questions came from these classes. Because my focus is completely exam-centric. I thoroughly analyze the previous year questions and take the classes. So here also when I'm taking classes, I ensure that I try my level best to ensure at least one question should come from each and every video. Okay. So this year, please, this linguistic, this one, all this reorganization of states becomes important. The chronology becomes important. Please focus. Okay. So coming back. Sir, once again, I am saying in the earlier videos also I said previous year questions are most important, very much important. I please sincerely request all of you to follow the previous year questions, to do the previous year questions than solving any random test series available in the market. Okay. Yes, coming back to reorganization of states. 1948, Government of India set up a commission known as S.K. Dhar Commission. S.K. Dhar Commission. However, and this Dhar Commission to check into the demand of the reorganization based on the linguistic states. However, it opposed or rejected linguistic reorganization. Okay, so there was huge protest by the local people. In against to the recommendations given by the S.K. Dhar Commission. Then INC, Indian National Congress, sets up a other committee known as, very famous committee known as JVP Committee. What is this JVP Committee? Set up by INC, sir, Indian National Congress. Please remember that JVP Committee was set up by INC. Who are the members of this JVP Committee? Jawaharlal Nehru, Vallabhbhai Patel, Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel, Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel and Pattabhi Sitaramaya. At this point of time, 1948, Pattabhi Sitaramaya was the chairman of INC. Okay, who is the chairman of INC in 1947, sir? Fuke. Do TTD. Else, if people who are aware of this answer, please type in comments. Who is the chairman of INC, Indian National Congress, in 1947. Okay, so INC set up a committee headed by Jawaharlal Nehru, Vallabhbhai Patel and Pattabhi Sitaramaya. However, this INC committee, they also submitted their report in 1949 and they also rejected creation of states on linguistic basis. Now next comes, then what happens, this earlier Dhar Commission was rejected this and then JVP committee also rejected this. But still the demand for the linguistic reorganization has not subsided. It gained more prominence in 1953. In 1953, in state of Madras, okay, at that point of time, this it consists of Madras, consists of Telugu speaking region, Okay. So in 1953, there was a demand for the creation of separate Andhra from Madras. So there was a hunger strike by Potti Sri Ramulu. Okay. He has done the hunger strike for more than around 53 days and he dies. Okay. So then again that it gains. It spreads like a wildfire. The creation of linguistic states, it gains more prominence, linguistic reorganization. Then in 1953, the state of Andhra is created. The state of Andhra, it is state of Andhra. Later in 1956, this Andhra was later came to be form as Andhra Pradesh. Okay, in 1953, the state of Andhra has created. This creation of Andhra further intensified the demand, further re-intensified reorganization demand, led to domino effect. You know domino effect, not Domino's pizza. Okay, what is domino effect? You have seen some videos on YouTube. There will be small small cornflake stuff like this. Okay, when this falls, this will also fall. This falls, and all these things. So when this, there was a create, this is known as domino effect. Okay, so then there was a demand rise. When you create a separate state, Andhra, on the basis of linguistic reorganization, then there was a demand. Many states have been requesting the center to create a new state. Then center comes up with a new commission in 1953. It is known as Fazal Ali Commission. It comes up with a new commission known as Fazal Ali Commission. Okay, who are the members of this? Also it is known as SRC, that is State Reorganization Committee or Commission. Who are the members, sir? One is Fazal Ali and other one is K.M. Panikkar and next one is H.N. Kunjru. Okay, these are the three members of the Fazal Ali Commission, or it is also known as State Reorganisation Commission. It submitted its report in 1956. Okay. It submitted its report in 1956, and although it rejected one language, one state. It rejected one language, one state, but it said it said a few states can be created on the basis of linguistic reorganization. Few states on linguistic reorganization. Further, it said that we need to consider four factors. If you want to create a new state, for creation of new state, we need to consider four factors. One is linguistic and cultural homogeneity. Okay. Next one, economic viability. Next one, it should promote welfare of all the people. Welfare of all the people in each state and collectively as a nation, and it should not hamper and pose as a it should not pose as a threat to unity and integrity of the nation. So these are the conditions led by the Fazal Ali Commission. So before this, there was a classification of fourfold states: Part A states, Part B states, and Part A, B, C, D states. There was a classification of all these things. So it said abolish this classification, and it asked for the creation of 14 states and 7 UTs. So based on the recommendation of this Fazal Ali Commission, we introduced 7th Constitutional Amendment Act. Based on the recommendation of SRC, we introduced 7th Constitutional Amendment Act. We abolished the classification into four groups. Okay, we abolished that and we created 14 states we created 14 states and 7 UTs. Okay. So now we'll be discussing after this SRC commission, what are the new states that were created. See, I hope I forgot to discuss one thing. Before, as soon as immediately after independence, there was a demand, there was issues with Junagadh, okay. There was next Hyderabad and J&K, okay. So these states after 1947 also immediately they have not joined. So this was, Junagadh is part of Gujarat. So it was joined after plebiscite. Plebiscite is nothing but like conducting like a referendum where we will be taking the decision, we will be considering the views of the people. Okay. This was by plebiscite. Next, Hyderabad was acceded to Indian Union in 1948 to military action. And later J&K it signed the through instrument of accession. Okay. So now coming back to the reorganization of states after 1956. So at 1956 we have 14 states and 7 UTs are available. 14 states and 7 UTs are available now. First, okay. First, what is the state, sir? First, state, sir. One more thing. Which is the first state in India created based on the linguistic reorganization? Linguistic reorganization. Many people will say, sir, just now you said 1953, Andhra Pradesh. Yes, right. But this is after independence. There is one more state which was created based on linguistic reorganization before independence, due TTD, sir, before independence. Okay, easily you can find it. Okay, fair. Coming back to after 1956. Okay, so 1956, earlier Maharashtra and Gujarat were in the same, they are together. So in 1950s, this was known as Bombay state. Okay, so in 1960, this Bombay state was bifurcated into Maharashtra and Gujarat. Okay, now Gujarat is the new state, that is 15th state. It is the first state after SRC. What is SRC, sir? State Reorganization Committee. Next, after this, Dadra Nagar Haveli. After this one, bifurcation of Bombay. So this Dadra Nagar Haveli till 1954, this is under the control of which country, sir? Portuguese. Okay. 1954 to 61, sir, this is important. Dadra Nagar Haveli and Daman Diu, these are important. Okay. These are under the control of local administrator. Okay. Who is this local administrator? He is chosen by the people, local people. And in 1961, we created it as a union territory. 10th Amendment Act 1961, we created into Union Territory. Converted into Union Territory. This is Dadra Nagar Haveli. Dadra and Nagar Haveli is also known as. Next one is Goa, Daman and Diu. Sir, I request you, all of you, to see the location of Daman and Diu and Dadra Nagar Haveli. Okay, many people not aware of this location. A few people are of the they are not aware whether they lie in the west coast and east coast. Please look the map. Okay, check the map. These are important. Okay, so this Goa and Daman and Diu till 1964, these are under the control of Portuguese. Okay, in 1961 we acquired by police action. Okay, what is the name of this police action, sir? This is Operation Vijay. Okay, by 12th Constitutional Amendment Act 1962, we gave for both of them status of Union Territory. However, later for Goa, we give the status of full statehood in 1987. Full statehood. Goa is now not a union territory. Now it is a, it enjoys the full statehood. Okay. Next, after this, Puducherry. Yes, sir. This is also known as Pondicherry. So this is in 1954. We acquired it from the French. Okay. And till 1962, it was administered as acquired territory. Okay. Next, in 1962, through 14th Constitutional Amendment Act, we gave them the status of Union Territory. Okay. I guess, sir, hope Puducherry is in different places. Karaikal, Mahe, and Yanam. Okay. Do TTD, this one. Where is Puducherry? It was Puducherry, Karaikal, Mahe, Yanam. Yanam is in Andhra Pradesh. Okay. Karaikal and Mahe, these are in Kerala. Okay. Puducherry and other one, Puducherry, it is near to Tamil Nadu. Okay. Just see those map also. These are also parts of Puducherry, but this part, Yanam, is present in Andhra Pradesh, and the Karaikal and Mahe are present in the Kerala state. Next, coming to 1963, that is Nagaland. Creation of Nagaland as the 16th state. Okay, earlier this Naga Hills and Tuensang, these regions, these are separated from Assam, and Nagaland was created. Okay, next, then comes 1966. This is 16th state. Gujarat is the 15th state, and after Gujarat, we have discussed about various union territories. Now it is the 16th state. In 1966, sir, earlier consider this, all this entire region was earlier Pipsu, or it is also earlier the entire region is Punjab. Okay, so now this is Punjab, this region was separated, this is Himachal Pradesh, and this is Haryana. Okay, so earlier this is entire region is Punjab, and later they were separated as this Hindi speaking region as Haryana, and the hill region as Himachal Pradesh, and largely it consists of six. Okay, so now in 1966, we created Haryana as 17th state. And Himachal Pradesh as 18th state. And in this year, we declared Chandigarh as Union Territory. Yes, next one. Now coming to 1972. So 1972 is the important year, because in 1972 there was major reorganization in Northeast region. Yes, why I am saying major reorganization, sir? It led to creation of three new states. That is Manipur, Tripura, and Meghalaya. This Manipur is created as 19th state. This Tripura was created as 20th state. Earlier, before this creation, earlier this as separate state, these both were considered as UTs. And Meghalaya was 21st state. Earlier creation of this Meghalaya, it was in earlier, it was considered as sub-state, as a part of Assam. Okay. By the way, sir, just quick recall. Yesterday video, earlier video, we discussed about sixth schedule. What are the various states, sir? AM, TM. What is A? It is Assam, Meghalaya, Tripura and Mizoram. Don't confuse Arunachal Pradesh or Manipur. Manipur and Arunachal Pradesh are not part of it. Okay. So 1972, the major reorganization of Northeast, it created the three states, that is Manipur, 19th state, Tripura, 20th state, and Meghalaya, 21st state. And Arunachal Pradesh and Mizoram were given the status of UTs. They are given the status of Union Territory. Clear, sir? 1972. This is the reason, because three new states were created and now Arunachal Pradesh and Mizoram were recognized as Union Territories. That's the reason 1972 major reorganization of Northeast region. Next comes Sikkim. Okay. In 1974. Before 19, this one, let's discuss the brief history of. Till 1974, it is under the Chogyal Kingdom. Under Chogyal Kingdom. After 1940, from 1947, Sikkim was considered as protectorate state. Okay, it became protectorate state of India. Protectorate state, where we'll be managing communication, defense, and external affairs. Okay, so it used to enjoy the status of protectorate state till 1974. Okay, so in 1974, they said Sikkim state, we want greater association with India. 1947, just reverse, remember, as 1974. They said we need a greater integration with India, so we given the status of associate state. Earlier protectorate state, now associate state. The status of associate state. However, again a referendum was held there. They said now we want a complete integration with India. Okay, so they said complete integration with India. So Sikkim was recognized as 22nd state in 1975, okay, through 36th Amendment Act. It was recognized as a 22nd state in 1975, okay. Next comes 1987. Okay, earlier also we discussed this year, 1987. In 1987, three states were given the full statehood, that is Mizoram, Arunachal Pradesh, Mizoram, Arunachal Pradesh, and Goa. So earlier this Mizoram, Arunachal Pradesh, and Goa, what are these, sir? Which status they are having? They are having the status of Union Territories. Now they have been recognized as states. This is Mizoram has become 23rd state, Arunachal Pradesh has become 24th state, and Goa has become the 25th state. Okay, so now they have given the full statehood. Next, coming fast forward to the year of 2000. Okay, so what are the three states we created in the 2000, sir? Chhattisgarh, okay, then Uttarakhand and Jharkhand. Chhattisgarh, Uttarakhand, and Jharkhand. Chhattisgarh, in which year, sir? This Chhattisgarh was created in the year 2000. It was as 26th state, Uttarakhand as 27th state, and Jharkhand as 28th state. Chhattisgarh, Uttarakhand, and Jharkhand. Clear? Later, coming fast forward to 2014, creation of Telangana. Okay, it separated from Andhra Pradesh, and it was recognized as the 29th state. Okay, and coming forward to 2019, what, sir? Now J&K and Ladakh were created, they were given the status of Union Territories. So we have 28 states and 9 Union Territories. What are the Union Territories, sir, existing at this point of time? This one, Chandigarh, Lakshadweep, Andaman and Nicobar, Puducherry, Daman and Diu, Dadra Nagar Haveli, NCR region plus J&K, NCR matlab Delhi, National Capital Region, Delhi, next one J&K and Ladakh, okay, 9 union territories. However, in 2020, now we have 28 states and 8 union territories. Why? We measured these both of these, Daman and Diu and Dadra Nagar Haveli. Okay. Hope this is the reorganization of states in India after independence. We finished reorganization of states. So please remember the chronology, because I expect one question from the chronology. Kindly arrange. They make you okay. Let me check to what extent you have remembered. Arrange them in the chronological order, sir. Chronological order of their creation. Okay. Do you need time to think or will you comment? Okay. Please comment. Okay. Please comment the order of creation. Okay. So I will give the first state. Okay. In this one, first it is A, which is the last state to be created, sir. That is D. Okay. Arrange which one was later. Okay. This is the reorganization of states. That's it, sir. I expect one question, so please be please focus on the timeline of this creation. Now coming to citizenship. Yes, sir. Citizenship also this year important, considering the Citizenship Amendment Act. Okay. So when we discuss current affairs, we'll be discussing current this one, Citizenship Amendment Act. But sir, one thing is for sure, I don't expect any direct question from the Citizenship Amendment Act. Very less chances in prelims particularly, because if there is, sir, one blind rule, always remember it is applicable to each and every subject. If any subject or if any topic is very much too much in news, then UPSC will not ask direct question. It may ask, suppose if this is the core essence of the CAA bill, instead of asking this on exact question on CAA, it will ask all the peripheral areas. Okay. So I don't expect any question on Citizenship Amendment Act, like what are the, how many minorities, which are the minorities who were given the benefits under the Citizenship Amendment Act. We are here under this, Hindus were also considered as minorities, since these are considered as minorities in other states. To which states it was applicable to, the people coming from which countries, that is Bangladesh, Pakistan and Afghanistan. So I don't expect these questions coming from this. Okay. When we discuss this Citizenship Amendment Act with regards to mains, then these are very much important. Sir, please focus. I don't see any possibility of question on particularly CAA, NPR and NRC. Okay. But other related issues, census. Okay. Because 2021 will be taking the census. Okay. So please focus on census. Census is conducted by, please do TTD on census and SCCC. SCCC is socio-economic caste census. So I see possibility coming questions on census. Census is under the control of which ministry, sir? Who conducts the census? Registered General of India. Okay, Registered General of India is under the control of which ministry? Many people think he is under the control of Ministry of Statistics Programming, Ministry of Statistics and Program Implementation. No, it's a big blunder. He is not under the control of Ministry of Statistics and Program Implementation. The Register of India is under the control of which ministry, sir? MHA, Ministry of Home Affairs. Ministry of Home Affairs. Okay. Once again, do TTD, task of the day, do research about in which viceroy introduced the census in India. When was the first year? If my memory serves me right, I guess 1872 is the first year when we conducted the census. Later from 1881, we are integrated this synchronized census and all these things. Please do TTD on this. Very much important, this census and SECC, socio-economic caste census. Abhitak, there is no question on prelims on socio-economic caste census. Okay. So when you're doing TTD for SECC, further there is further there are automatic exclusion and deprivation indicators. Please do focus on them also. Deprivation indicators. Okay. So now coming back to the discussion on citizenship. Or we may expect one question, sir, this one. Hope you know secularism, okay? Is secularism part of basic structure of Indian constitution? Is secularism part of basic structure of Indian constitution? Yes, sir. Secularism is considered as a part of basic structure of Indian constitution. It was said in S.R. Bombay case. S.R. Bombay case, it was said secularism as part of basic structure. You may ask, sir, what is the relation between citizenship and secularism you are asking? And because this one, it was, what is the important criticism of this, of Citizenship Amendment Act, sir? It was said that it is going against the credentials of the Indian secularism credentials. So that's the reason I am just sensitizing you about the one information. In S.R. Bombay case, it was said that secularism is part of the basic structure of the constitution. Okay. Yes, coming back. In our constitution, Article 5 to 11 talks about citizenship. Article 5 to 11 talks about citizenship. But to be precise, the provisions in the constitution with respect to citizenship are transitionary or not much, they are not comprehensive. First, we will be discussing why I am saying comprehensive, why I am saying they are not comprehensive. What Article 5 talks about? Article 5 talks about citizenship at the commencement of constitution. Citizenship at the commencement of constitution. It says who can get the citizenship at the commencement of constitution. What are the conditions of it? One just go through this either Lakshmikant or the Bay Act. These are very simple provisions. Who are the people who are born in India or his parents and the parents born in Indian territory. Or the very basic things, or he should be a resident for 5 years. Okay, very basic provision. Just go through them. Since these are crash courses, I'll be rushing through them. Just I want to sensitize you about them. Okay, next Article 6. Okay, Article 6 talks about rights of citizenship of people who migrated to India. The rights of citizenship of migrants from Pakistan to India. From Pakistan to India, it talks about. Next, Article 7 talks about Article 6 talks about rights of migrants who from Pakistan to India, whereas Article 7 talks about rights of citizenship of certain migrants. Certain migrants to Pakistan. Remember, Article 6 is talking about rights of citizenship of certain migrants who migrated from Pakistan to India. Who migrated from Pakistan to India. Whereas Article 7 is talking about rights of citizenship of certain migrants who migrated to Pakistan. Okay, who migrated to Pakistan, but later they came to India. It talks about this one, Article 7. Next, Article 8 talks about okay, rights of citizenship of certain migrants residing outside India. Of rights of citizenship of certain people, few people residing outside India. Okay. Next, Article 9 talks about if you voluntarily acquire any citizenship, it will be cancelled. This is Article 9 talks about. Next, Article 10 says that continuance of rights of citizenship. Sir, what is this continuance of rights of citizenship? You will be saying. I'll make it clear in the next step. Okay. Article 11 talks about Parliament. Parliament can make law. To regulate citizenship. Okay. Article 11 says that Parliament can make law to regulate citizenship. Okay. So what is this Article 10 is talking? When Parliament make laws, okay, the rights of the citizens who are having the citizenship, their rights will be continued. Okay. This is Article 10 talking about continuance of rights of citizenship. Okay. Next one, Article 11 empowers the Parliament to make law on citizenship. In fact, using this provision, the Parliament made law on citizenship, that is which we are referring to Citizenship Amendment Act. Okay. So using Article 11, the Parliament has made up Citizenship Act 1955. Okay. In fact, this is the most Citizenship Act 1955 is the comprehensive legislation on citizenship than the articles which are present in the Constitution. The Articles 5 to 11 largely talks about transitionary provisions. Okay, when we are making when immediately in 1947 it will lead to the creation of partition, sudden migrant movement of people, huge migration from Pakistan to India and all these things. Okay, it was said more than 10 million people have been migrated from these places. So this, it talks about Article 5 to 11 are largely, the Constitution talks about the temporary provisions, transitionary or temporary provisions. The detailed provisions of the citizenship was laid in Citizenship Act 1955. Clear? Now we'll be discussing about Citizenship Act 1955. This is the comprehensive legislation on the Citizenship Act. It lays conditions for the acquisition of citizenship, matlab how you will be getting the citizenship, acquisition of citizenship, and termination of loss of citizenship. It lays guidelines for the acquisition of citizenship and the loss of citizenship. We'll be discussing what are the grounds, what are the various criteria for acquisition of citizenship. How you can obtain a citizenship? How you can acquire, sir? By birth, by incorporation of a territory, by naturalization, by descent, and by registration. By birth, when you take birth in India, incorporation of territory, when our Indian government acquires any territory, by naturalization, by living, the conditions were laid that around 11 and 12 years. Okay, these provisions are very clearly mentioned in Lakshmikant and all these things. Just have a quick look of them. By descent, matlab by lineage. If your parents are having Indian citizenship, on this basis you will also be getting. And by registration, these are the grounds you can acquire the citizenship. Okay, please remember: by birth, by incorporation of territory, by naturalization, by descent, and by registration. And it also mentions about how you will be losing your citizenship. Loss of citizenship. loss of citizenship. How you will be losing the citizenship? On three grounds, that is renunciation. And next one is termination. And next one is deprivation. On these three grounds, you will be losing the renunciation. Matlab, when you acquire citizenship of, suppose if you acquire citizenship of US or any other country, you will be voluntarily giving up your Indian citizenship. Termination, when government comes to know that you acquired the citizenship of any other country, suppose you acquired the citizenship of UK, but you haven't disclosed to government that you acquired the citizenship. So please remember, in India we have a concept of only single citizenship. We doesn't have any concept of dual citizenship. You can only have the Indian citizenship. Okay, so if you are holding the, what is renunciation? Just take you are having the citizenship of UK or British. So when you are having the citizenship of UK, when you say that, when you inform to government, I am getting the I have the citizenship of UK and I want to lose my citizenship, I want to give up my Indian citizenship, then it is known as renunciation. What is termination, sir? You acquired the citizenship of UK, but you haven't communicated to government that you acquired the UK citizenship. So when later, when government comes to know that you acquired UK citizenship and you haven't communicated to government, or when you haven't given up your citizenship by renunciation, then government automatically terminates your citizenship. Okay. Next, deprivation. Suppose some other foreigners and others who acquired the Indian citizenship by means of fraud or any other things, then, or if they do any, they communicate with any enemies during war, any other things, then the government have the right to deprive their citizenship. If they haven't respected the Indian constitution and any other things, then government can remove their citizenship. That is the deprivation of the citizenship. Okay. Please, let me ask you one simple question. You know who is the one of the India's famous shooter, okay, rifle shooter, who got Olympic prize? India shooter who got Olympic medal. You know him? Abhinav Bindra. He's taking part in the, he's active, or he retired, sir? He retired, right? I guess he is retired, okay? So just please remember, Bindra retired, okay? See the magic. Okay, what is this Bindra, sir? This is acquisition of citizenship. What is this one, sir? This is loss of citizenship. How? This is citizenship by birth, by incorporation of territory, by naturalization, by descent, and by registration. This is Bindra. Next, RTD, that is renunciation, okay, loss of citizenship, termination, and deprivation. These are the various grounds. Sir, please remember one thing. Suppose if I give a question, our constitution recognizes five grounds for acquisition of citizenship. Our constitution recognizes five grounds for the acquisition of citizenship. What are those five grounds, sir? This Bindra. There is nothing for R, okay? So Bindra. Is this statement true or false? Once again, I am repeating the statement. Our constitution recognizes five grounds for the acquisition of citizenship. Is it right or wrong? True or false? So obviously true, because now only you just now said it is B for acquiring citizenship by birth, by incorporation of territory, by naturalization, by descent, and by registration. No, sir. It is false. It is not true. This is not recognized by our constitution, but this is recognized by the Citizenship Act 1955. These five grounds are recognized by the Citizenship Act 1955, not by the constitution. Please be careful, because many of the students commit a big blunder. In prelims, when we give this kind of question, our constitution recognizes the following five grounds as a grounds for acquisition of citizenship. No, sir, please, it is false. All these five rights are recognized under Citizenship Act 1955. Please remember them. Don't commit these silly mistakes. Okay. Next, one more important thing. Sorry, please excuse this. Okay. What are the fundamental rights? What are the fundamental rights which are available? Which are available only to Indian citizens? What are the fundamental rights which are only available to Indian citizens? Please remember them. Article 15, Article 16, Article 19, 29, and 30. Only exclusively these fundamental rights are available only to Indian citizens. Okay, sir. Fundamental rights from 13 to 32, constitutional remedies and other things, 33, 34, 35 also. Okay, 13 to 32, largely these are applicable, these are largely available to any persons. Okay, largely to all the persons. But these are exclusively, this Article 15, 16, 19, 29, 30, these are available only to Indians. These rights are not available to foreigners or these rights are not available to foreigners, whereas the other rights are available to foreigners also. That's the reason I said these are the rights which are available only to Indian citizens. Article 15, 16, 19, 29, 30. Clear? So these are the important provision of the citizenship. In the next video, we'll be talking about. I'll be starting with fundamental rights. In fundamental rights, considering the crash course and considering the limitation of time, I'm not going to discuss all the fundamental rights. I received a request from the students, sir. Article 12, 13, 14, 15, 16. These are slightly confusing. So please discuss. I'll be only discussing them, and then I'll be discussing DPSPs, and then I'll be discussing the fundamental duties, and then we'll be we'll jump to parliament chapter. After parliament, we'll be discussing emergency provisions and then other important topics which are in use. Okay, so I'll be discussing only 12, 13, 14, 15, 16. If you need any other fundamental rights, if you have any confusion with regards to other fundamental rights, please comment. I will take up those topics in the subsequent videos. Thank you. Have a great day.